Thank you. beauty and modesty and won't declare themselves. So, until she makes her own choice, there's no comfort for anybody else.
This is perhaps the only village in the world that possesses an endowed corps of professional bridesmaids who are bound to be on duty every day from 10 to 4. And it is at least 6 months since our services were required. The pious charity by which we exist is practically wasted.
We shall be disendowed.
Each Lord. from that little heart of thine, is there none here away whom thou couldst love?
And if even if there were such a one, verily it would ill become me to tell him so.
Nay, dear one, where true love is, there is little need for prim formality.
Hush, dear aunt, for thy words pain me sorely. Hung in a plated dish cover to the knocker of a workhouse door, with naught that I could call mine own, save a change of baby linen and a book of etiquette. Little wonder I have always regarded that work as a voice from a parent's tomb. This hallowed volume, composed, if I may believe the title page, by no less an authority than the wife of a Lord Mayor, has been, through life, my guide and monitor. By its solemn precepts, I have learnt to test the moral worth of all who approach me. The man who bites his bread or eats peas with a knife, I look upon as a lost creature. And he who has not acquired the proper way of entering or leaving a room is the object of my pitying horror. There are those in this village who bite their nails, dear aunt. Oh, and nearly all are wont to use their pocket combs in public places. In truth, I could pursue this painful theme much further. But behold, I have said enough. he resembleth all the youths in this village, in that he is unduly bashful in my presence. And lo, it is hard to bring him to the point. But soft, he is here.
What he ought to think that if she weren't quite so particular, I might venture. But no, no. Even then, I would be unworthy of her.
Oh, my kind master is sad. Dear Sir Riven Murgatroyd.
Hush! As you love me, breathe not that hated name. 20 years ago, in horror at the prospect of inheriting that hideous title, and with it the ban that compels all who succeed to the baronetcy to commit at least one deadly crime per day for life, and after extensive reconstructive facial surgery work, I fled my home and concealed myself in this innocent village under the name of Robin O'Capple. My younger brother, Descard, believing me to be dead, succeeded to the title and its attendant curse. For 20 years, I've been dead and buried. Don't dig me up now.
Dear master, it shall be as you wish, for have I not sworn to obey you forever in all things? Yet, as we are here alone, and as I belong to that particular description of good old man to whom the truth is a refreshing novelty, let me call you by your own right title once more. Sir Riven Murgatroyd, Baronet of Ruddigore. It's like 8 hours at the Cavern Club.
My poor old friend, would that there were more like you.
What would there more indeed? What would there? Oh, but I bring you good tidings. Your foster brother Richard has returned from sea. His ship, the Tom Pit, lies yonder at anchor. And he himself is even now in this very village.
My beloved foster brother. No, no, it cannot be!
It is even so! And see, he comes this way!
Stars, we were hardy British stars who had pity on a poor Bollywood, do you see?
very dearest friend. Welcome home again after 10 long years at sea. It is such deeds as yours that cause our flag to be loved and dreaded throughout the civilized world.
Our Lord love you, Rob. That is but a trifle to what we have done in the way of sparing lives. I believe I may say that the master of little Tomtit has spared more French frigates than any other craft afloat. But it's not for a British seaman to brag, so I'll just stow my jaw and tackle and belay. But fast healing, messmate! What's got you all a cockbill?
Alas, Dick, I love a rosemary bud, and love in vain.
You love in vain? Come, that's too good. Why, you're a fine, strapping, muscular young fellow. Tall and strong as a gallant mast, taut as a forestay. Aye, and a baronite to boot, if all have their rights.
Hush, Richard, not a word about my true rank, which none here suspect. Yes, I know well enough that few men are better calculated to win a woman's heart than I. I'm a fine fellow, Dick, and worthy any woman's love. Happy the girl who gets me, say I. But I'm timid, Dick. Shy, nervous, modest, retiring, and diffident. And I cannot tell her, Dick. I cannot tell her. You've no idea what a poor opinion I have of myself, and how little I deserve it.
Robin, do you recall how, years ago, we swore that, come what might, we would always act on the dictates of our hearts?
I did, and I've always kept that oath. In doubt, difficulty, and danger, I have always asked my heart what I should do, and it has never failed me.
Right, let your heart be your compass, and with a clear conscience on your binnacle light, you'll sail 10 knots on a bowline, free of shoals, rocks, and quicksands. What does my heart tell me in this here difficult situation? Why, it says, Dick, it says. It calls me Dick because it's known me from a babby. Dick, you ain't shy, you ain't modest. Speak up then, as is. Robin, my lad, just you lay me alongside, and when she's becalmed under my lee, I shall spin a yarn that shall serve to fish you two together for life.
Will you do this thing for me? Can you, do you think? Yes, there's no false modesty about you. You're what I would call bumptious self-assertiveness. I mean the expression in its complimentary sense. Has already made a bosun's mate of you, and will make an admiral of you in time, if you work it properly. You dear, incompetent old impostor. Why, I'd give my right arm for one-tenth of your modest assurance. My boy, you may take from me that of all the afflictions accursed, with which a man's saddle and hampered and held, a diffident nature's the worst. Though clever as clever can be, a Crichton of early romance, you must tell it, you stumbled and blew, tell me, don't trust me, you haven't a chance. If you wish in the world to plunge, your poor men at your farm might hunt, you must tell it, you stumbled and blew, tell me, don't trust me, you haven't a chance. Now take, for example, my case, I've a bright intellectual brain. In all under the city, there's no one so witty, I force you again and again. I've a highly intelligent face, my features do not be denied, but whatever I try, sir, I fail in and why, sir?
I don't know.
I'm a modesty personified. If you wish in the world to advance, your poor men is your father in house. You must stand it and stump it and blow it and trump it and trust me, you haven't a chance. As a point and tender weight, I passion and fervor and grace. From Ovid and Horace to Swinburne and Morris, they all of them take a back place. And I sing and I play and I paint, though not unconscious I. But just say so a treason, you ask me the reason.
No, I didn't.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you did. I'm a diffident, modest, and shy. If you wish in the world to advance, your poor men at your farm to advance, you must stand and stumble and blow and trumpet or trumpet, you have the chance.
If you wish in the world to advance, your poor men at your farm to advance, you must stand and stumble and blow and trumpet or trumpet, you have the chance.
Such a poor opinion of himself. for a finer fellow don't walk. But I will do my best for him. Plead for him, as if it was for your own father. That's what my heart's remarking to me just now. Ah, but here she comes. Steady, steady it is. Oh, but by the Port Admiral, she is a tight little craft. Oh, but come, come, she's not for you now, Dick. And yet, she's fit to marry the Lord Nelson. Oh, by the flag of all England, I can't look upon her unmoved.
Sir, you are agitated.
Aye, my lad, well said. I am agitated, true enough. Took flat aback, my girl. Tis not, but 'twill pass. This heart of mine's remarking to me like anything. Question is, have I a right to disregard its promptings?
Can I do aught to relieve thine anguish? For it seemeth to me that thou art in sore trouble. This apple.
No, my lass, 'tain't that. I'm took flat aback. Oh, but I've never seen anything like you in all my born days! Ah, buckle me if you ain't the loveliest girl I've ever set eyes on. Can't say fairer than that, can I?
No. The question is it meet that an utter stranger should thus express himself? Yes, always speak the truth.
I've no thought of saying this here to you on my own account, for, truth to tell, I've been chartered by another. But when I look upon you, my heart, it up and it says it. This is the very verse for you, Dick. Speak up to her, Dick, it says. It calls me Dick because we went to school together. Oh, tell her all, Dick. Never sail under false colours. It's me. That's what my heart's telling me to say, and in my rough, common sailor fashion, I've said it. And now I await your reply. Oh, I'm trembling, miss. Oh, looky here. That's nervousness.
Now, how should a maiden deal with such an one? Keep no one in unnecessary suspense. Behold, I will not keep you in unnecessary suspense. In accepting an offer of marriage, do so with apparent hesitation. I take you, but with a certain show of reluctance. Avoid any appearance of eagerness. Though you will bear in mind, I am far from anxious to do so. A little show of emotion would not be misplaced. Pardon this tear.
Oh, Rose, you've made me the happiest blue jacket in all of England. Why, I shouldn't like to change places with the Admiral of the Fleet, no matter who he's hugging on at this present moment. But, asking your pardon, miss. Might I be permitted to salute the flag I'm going to sail under?
An engaged young lady must not permit too many familiarities. Once.
The battle's roar is over, oh my love. Embrace thy tender lover, oh my love. From tempest swelter, from water long, oh give me shelter within those arms. Oh give me
thank you.
news. Have you spoken to her?
Aye, my lad, I have, so to speak, spoken.
And she refuses?
Why, no, I can't truly say she do.
Then she accepts, my darling!
Hail the bridegroom, hail the bride, when the nuptial knot is tied, in their praises, in their praises, hail the bridegroom, hail the bride.
Now, what should a maiden do when she is embraced by the wrong gentleman?
Belay, my lad, belay, you don't understand.
Oh, sir, belay, I beseech you.
You see, it's like this. She accepts, but it's me.
You?
Hail the bridegroom, hail the bride, when the nuptial knot is tied, in their praises, in their praises,
hail the bridegroom,
hail the bride.
Now then, what does this mean?
Oh, my poor lad, my heart grieves for thee. Well, it's like this. The moment that I saw her, and just as I was going to mention your name, my heart, it up and it says it. Dick, you fell in love with her yourself. Oh, be honest and sailor-like. Don't skulk under these false colours. Take her, you dog, and with her my blessing.
Hail the bridegroom, hail the bride, when the nuptial knot is tied, in the
will you be wet? Go away.
Vulgar girls. My poor lad, what else was I to do? I'm bound to obey my heart's dictates.
Of course. No doubt. I quite see that. I don't mind, I suppose. Not particularly.
Only, well,
well, it is disappointing, you know.
Oh, but sir, I knew not that thou didst seek me in wedlock. Or in very truth, I would not have hearkened unto this man, for he is but a lowly mariner and very poor withal. Whereas thou art a tiller of the land, and thou hast fat oxen, and many sheep and swine, a considerable dairy farm, and much corn and oil.
Ah, it is true, my lass, but it's done now, ain't it, Rob?
Still, it may be that I am not happy in thy love. I am passing young and little able to judge. Moreover, as to thy character, I know not.
Nay, Rose, I'll answer for that. Dick has won thy love fairly. Broken hearted as I am, I'll stick up for Dick through thick and thin.
Ah, thank you, messmate. That's well said. That's spoken honest. Thank you, Rob. Thank you.
Yet, methinks I've heard that sailors are but worldly men and little prone to lead serious or thoughtful lives.
And what then? Admit that Dick is not a steady character? And that when he's excited, he uses language that would make your hair curl. Grant that he does, it's the truth, and I'm not going to deny it. But look at his good qualities. He's as nimble as a pony, and his hornpipe is the talk of the fleet. That's only a bit of it.
Thank you, Rob. Thank you.
But it may be that he drinketh strong waters, which do amuse a man and make him even as the wild beasts of the desert.
Well, suppose he does. And I don't say that he don't, for rum's his bane and ever has been. He does drink, but what of it? Look at his arms, tattooed to the shoulder. No, no, I won't hear a word against Dick.
But I've heard that mariners are rarely true to those whom they profess to love.
Granted, granted. And I don't say that Dick isn't as bad as any of them. You are. You know you are, you dog. A devil of a fellow. A regular out a Count Lothario. But what then? You can't have everything. And a better hand at turning in a dead eye don't walk a deck. And what an accomplishment that is in a family man. No! No, no! I won't hear a word against Dick. I'll stick up for Dick through thick and thin.
Ah, thank you, Rob. You're a true friend. I have acted according to the dictates of my heart, and orders such as them no man should disobey.
Say it all expression wide, your heart should be your only guide. With some see it very wide, yourself in all to find.
My heart says to this maiden strike, she's kept it you, she's just the sort of girl you like. You know you do, if other men are heart should gain, I shall resign. That's what it says to me quite plain, this heart of mine, this heart of mine.
My heart says you'll look up the slot with acres wide. You mean to settle all you've got upon your mind. It don't pretend to shake my pecs by word or sign. It merely states the simple facts. This heart of mine, this heart of mine.
Taking it since my heart's in white, it knows it's black. It thinks it left, it knows it's right. Heart of intact, I must obey its latest strain. You tell me so. But should it change its mind again, I'll let you know.
Saying all I so should mind, but the heart should be your guide. But each one could make you find your heart a heart that does not know its mind. A heart that does not know its mind.
Why must stay? Don't call.
Then you don't love Sir Despard Murgatroyd. All mad girls love him. I love him. And poor Mad Margaret. Crazy Meg. Poor Meg.
Oh, thou lovest the bad baronet of Ruddigore. How horrible.
Too horrible. You pity me.
Pity my mother. The squirrel had a mother, but she drowned.
Sing a brave song in our parts. It runs somewhat thus. The cat and the dog and the little puppy sat down in her. Sat down in her. Oh, I forget what they sat down in, but so the song goes. Listen. I've come to pinch her.
Mercy, whom?
You mean who?
Nay, it is the accusative after the verb.
True. I've come to pinch Rosemary Vardemar!
Rosemary Vardemar!
I love him. He loved me once. That's all gone. He gave me an Italian glance and made me his. He will give her an Italian glance and make her his. But it shall not be. Nay, for I'll stamp on her. I'll stamp on her, stamp on her, stamp on her! Did you ever kill anyone? No. Why not? I killed a fly this morning. It buzzed, and I wouldn't have it, and so it died. And so shall she.
But I am Rose Maybud, and I have fain not died, Pa.
You are Rose Maybud?
Yes, sweet Rose Maybud.
Strange. They told me she was beautiful. He loves you. Oh, no, it cannot be. If I thought that, I would treat you as the auctioneer and land agent treated the ladybird. Then I would break you asunder.
Oh, nay, be pacified. For behold, I am pledged to another. And lo, we are to be wedded this very day.
Oh, swear me that. Come to a commissioner and put it on affidavit. I made an affidavit once, but it died. It died. But see, they come. Sir Despard and his evil crew. Go hide. They are all mad. Quite mad.
What makes you think so?
They sing choruses in public. That's mad enough, I think. They will seize you quite softly, quite softly.
Greetings. utterly mad.
Confess.
Because I am thoroughly mad.
Oh, yes.
You'll see it at once in my face. Oh, why am I thus here?
Oh, why?
It's the workings of conscience, of course.
Fine, fine.
And Huskiner stands for remorse.
Oh, my.
At least it does so in my case. When in crime one is fully employed,
like you,
your expression gets warped and destroyed.
It too.
It's a penalty none can avoid.
How true.
I once was a nice looking youth, but like stone from a strong cannon bolt,
a trice,
I rushed at my terrible coat.
That's vice.
Observe the unpleasant result.
Not nice.
Indeed, I am telling the truth. Oh, innocent, happy, though poor.
Like me.
If I had been virtuous, I'm sure.
Like me.
I should be as nice looking as you.
Maybe.
You're very nice looking indeed. Oh, innocent, listen in time.
We go.
Avoid an existence of crime.
Just so.
Oh, you'll be as ugly as I.
No, no.
And now, if you please, we'll proceed.
Me, whose hands are certainly steeped in infamy, but whose heart is the heart of a little child. But what is a poor baronet to do when a whole picture gallery of ancestors steps down from their frames and threaten him with an excruciating death if he hesitated to commit his daily crime? But, I am even. Then I get my crime over first thing in the morning, and then, ha ha, for the rest of the day, I do good. I do good. I do good. 2 days since, I stole a child and built an orphanage. Yesterday, I robbed that mail train and endowed a bishop. Today, I carry off Rose Weber and atone with a new Coventry cathedral. This is what it is to be the sport and toy of a picture gallery. But I will be bitterly revenged upon them. I will have them all repainted by Andy Warhol. And no one will ever recognise their faces again.
Asking your honour's pardon.
Huh? Observed. And by a mariner. What would you with me, fellow?
Your honour, I'm a poor man of warsman, becalmed in the doldrums.
I don't know that.
And I make bold to ask your honour's pardon. Does your honour know what it is to have a heart?
My honour knows what it is to have the complete apparatus for conducting the circulation of the blood through the veins and arteries of the human body.
Yes, but does your honour know what it is to have a heart that ups and looks you in the face and gives you quarter-deck orders that it's life and death to disobey?
I've not a heart of that description. But I have a picture gallery that presumes to take that liberty.
Well, you see, Your Honour, it's like this. Your Honour had an elder brother.
It had?
Who should have inherited your title, and with it, its curse.
Aye, but he died. Oh, Riven.
He didn't.
He did. Not.
He didn't. On the contrary, he lives in this here very village under the name of Robin Oakapple, and he's going to marry Rose Mayburn this very day.
Riven?
going to marry Rose Maybud? Can this be possible?
Now, the question I wanted to ask your honour is, ought I to tell you this?
I don't know. It's a delicate point. I think maybe you ought, but I'm not sure. But I think so.
Yes, that's what my heart tells me to say. It says, Dick! It says, it calls me Dick because it's entitled to take that liberty. That young girl would recoil from him if she knew what he really were. Oh, would you let this young girl take this false step and never fire a shot across her bow to bring her to? No, it says, you did not ought. And I shan't ought, accordingly.
Then you really feel yourself at liberty to tell me that my elder brother lives, that I may charge him with his cruel deceit and transfer to his shoulders the hideous thraldom under which I've laboured for so many years? Free! Free at last! Free to live a blameless life and to die beloved and regretted by all who knew me.
You understand?
I think I do. Finger out checking this step to be taken, it's neatly planned.
I think so too. A readily meant to never regret. For duty must be done. The rule applies to everyone. And painful though the duty be, to shirk the task, to fiddly-dee, to shirk the task, to fiddly-dee, to shirk the task, to shirk the task, to fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-dee.
Bridegroom comes.
Likewise, the bride and maidens are very laced and merry. They are a chump.
To lash their pride, we're always a pity, the pretty committee. For duty must be done. The rule applies to everyone, and painful though their duty be. To shirk the task, to fiddly-dee. To shirk the task, to fiddly-dee. To shirk the task, to shirk the task, to fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-fiddly-dee.
Thank you.
and summer goes far.
and I at once obeyed. I knew 'twould blight thy parting fate. I knew 'twould cause thee anguish great. But did I therefore hesitate? No, I at once obeyed.
Thank you. Thank you.
we, you see. I am a jolly Jack Tar, my star, and you are the fairest, the richest, and reddest of innocent lasses. You are by far more innocent lasses. You are. And when a pilgrim begins, say, over life's treacherous sea with me, and as for bad weather, we'll brave it together, and you should creep under my lee, my wee. And you should creep under my lee, my wee. For you are such a smart little craft, such a beautiful, sweet little craft, such a bright little tent.
Such a beautiful, 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 such a beautiful
fulfilled my accursed doom. I have duly committed a crime a day, not a great crime, I trust, but still, in the eyes of one as strictly regulated as I wish to be, a crime. But will my ghostly ancestors be satisfied with what I have done? Or will they regard it as an unworthy substitute? Oh, my forefathers, woes in blood! There came at last a day when, sick of crime, you each and every vowed to sin no more. And so, in agony, called welcome death to free you from your cloying guiltiness. Let the sweet song of that repentant hour soften your long dead hearts and tune your souls to mercy on your poor posterity.
Hey! thou canst not now avoid.
Alas, poor ghost.
The pity you express for nothing goes. We spectres are the jollier crew than you perhaps suppose.
We spectres are the jollier crew than you
When the night wind howls in the chimney cowls, and the bat in the moonlight flies, and inky clouds, like funeral shrouds, sail over the midnight skies. When the footpads quail, and the night birds quail, and black doth bay at the moon, then is the spectre's holiday, then is the ghost high noon. Oh, then is the ghost high noon. And the mists lie low on the fen. From little stones are gathered the blooms that once were women and men. And away they go with a mop and a mow to the revel that ends too soon. For cockcrow limits the holy day, the dead of the night's high noon. The dead of the night's high noon. Take flight with a kiss, perhaps, on her latter chaps, and a grisly grin good night, till the welcome bell of the midnight bell rings forth its jolliest tune, and ushered in our next high holy day, the dead of the night's high noon. The dead of the night's high noon. Be an old master, and you will be sorry you spoke lightly of me.
And may I ask why you have left your frames?
It is our duty to see that our successors commit their daily crimes in a conscientious and workmanlike fashion. It is our duty to remind you that you are evading the conditions under which you are permitted to exist.
Really? I don't know what you have. I've only been a bad baronet a week, and I've committed a crime punctually every day.
Let us inquire into this. Monday!
Monday was a bank holiday.
True. Tuesday.
On Tuesday, I made a false income tax return.
That's nothing! Nothing at all.
Everybody does that.
It's expected of you.
Wednesday!
On Wednesday, I forged a will.
Whose will?
My own.
My good sir, you can't forge your own will.
Can't I, though? I like that. Besides, I did. If a man can't forge his own will, whose will can he forge?
There's something in that. Yes, it seems reasonable.
At first sight, it does.
A man can do what he likes with his own.
I suppose he can.
Well then, he can forge his own will, stupid. On Thursday, I shot a fox.
That's better. Pass the fox, I think. Yes, pass the fox. Friday.
On Friday, I forged a check.
Whose check?
Old Adam's.
But old Adam hasn't got a banker.
I didn't say I forged his banker. I said I forged his check. On Saturday, I disinherited my only son.
But you haven't got a son?
No, not yet. You see, I disinherited him in advance to save time. By this arrangement, he'll be born ready disinherited.
I see, but I don't think you can do that.
My good sir, if I can't disinherit my own unborn son, whose unborn son can I disinherit?
These arguments sound very well, but I can't help thinking that if they were reduced to syllogistic form, they wouldn't hold water. Now quite understand us. We are foggy. But we do not permit our forgiveness to be presumed upon. Unless you undertake to... Suppose we say, carry off a lady. All those in favor of carrying off a lady. All those of the contrary opinion. Oh, you're never satisfied. Yes, unless you undertake to carry off a lady at once. I don't care what lady, any lady. Choose your lady. You perish in inconceivable agonies.
Carry off a lady? Certainly not. Not on any account. I have the greatest respect for ladies, and I wouldn't do anything of the kind for worlds. No, no. I'm not that kind of baronet, I assure you. And if that's all you have to say, you'd better go back to your friends.
Very good. Then let the agony
come in.
No! No! No!
Very well, isn't it?
No! I can't say
it! It gets worse by the degree.
No! 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 Stop! I want to speak!
Better?
Yes. Better now. Whew.
Well, do you consent?
But it's such an ungentlemanly thing to do.
Very good. Carry on now.
No! 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 I can't stand it! No! I agree! It shall be done!
Today!
Today!
At once!
At once! I retract! I apologize! I had no idea it was anything like that.
He heals, he answers to our call. We do not ask for more. A sturdy fellow, after all this latest Ruddigore. A sturdy fellow, after all this latest Ruddigore. Will perish in a world of woes, who dare or will be blind. We want your pardon, there we go.
We want your pardon, there we go. For how?
at once, or perish in horrible agonies. Oh, go. Go to yonder village and carry off a maiden. I don't care which, only bring her here at once. Not a word, but obey. Fly!
Oh, Master! When I think of all that you have done for me, I fall at your feet!
hug your knees.
Hush! This is not well. This is calculated to provoke remark. Be composed, I beg.
Oh, you are angry with poor little Mad Margaret.
No, not angry. But an army officer should learn to eschew melodrama. Visit the poor by all means and give them tea and barley water. But don't do it as if you were administering a bowl of deadly nightshade. It upsets them. And then, when you nurse sick people and find them not as well as could be expected, why go into hysterics?
Why not?
Because it's too jumpy for a sick room.
Oh, how strange. Oh, Master, how can I express the all-absorbing gratitude?
Now!
Yes, dear, I know. It shan't happen again. Tell you one of poor Mad Margaret's odd thoughts. Well then, I am lying awake at night, and the pale moonlight streams through the lattice casement. Fancies crowd my poor mad brain, and I sometimes think that if we could hit upon a word for you to use when I'm about to relapse, some word that teems witted and meaning, like amazing stoke. They call me to my senior self.
Don't cry, my love. Basingstoke, you know. only to trample them in the dust when they were at the very zenith of their fullness. Oh, Pfizer Pie, she trusted you.
Did she? What a scoundrel I must have been. There, there, my love, don't cry. Buxton, you know, Buxton.
It's burning stone!
Yes, yes, of course it is. Basingstoke.
They make it so!
Yes, yes, it's all right. There, there, don't cry. It's all right. He's married you now. That is, I say, which of us has married her?
Oh, I've married her.
Oh, I'm glad of that. Yes, he's married you now. Anything more disreputable than my conduct seems to have been, I've never even heard of. But my mind is made up. I will defy my ancestors. I will refuse to obey their behest. Thus, by courting death, atone in some degree for the infamy.
Infamy!
They've all got it in for me. Of my career.
Oh, I knew it, I knew it. God bless you.
My eyes are fully open to my awful situation. I shall go at once to Robin and make him adoration. I shall tell him I've recovered my forgotten moral senses and I don't think I can take any or any consequence. Thou do not want to punish by the sword or by the dagger, but a martyr may indulge a little pardonable swagger, and a word or two of compliment my vanity would flatter. But I've got to die for honor, so it really doesn't matter.
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 Matter, 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 matter.
If I were not a little man and generally silly, I should give you my advice upon this subject willingly. I should show you in a moment how to grapple with the question and really be astonished at the force of my suggestion. On this subject I shall try to work with a value woman letter full of excellent suggestions when I feel a little better. But at present time the paper help us hands any matter. So I keep them to myself, my opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter.
My opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter.
Her opinion doesn't matter. Matter, 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 matter.
Well, I'd been so lucky as to have a strange brother who could have been right when he discovered I was earning Richard Johnson's money fever, which I knew I had been my intentions and would have made a rather interesting idle, and I might have lived and died a rather decent little wiggle. This particularly rapid, unintelligible pattern, which you haven't really heard, and if it is, it doesn't matter.
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 This particularly rapid, unintelligible pattern isn't generally heard, and if it is, it doesn't matter. This particularly rapid, unintelligible.
Master, the deed is done.
What deed?
She is here, alone, unprotected.
Oh. Who?
The maiden. I carried her off. I had her hard task, for she fought like a tiger cat.
Great heavens, I had forgotten her! I had hoped you had died unspotted by crime, but I am foiled again, and by a tiger cat. Produce her and leave us. I expected.
Well, sir, and what would you with me? Oh, you have begun bravely, bravely indeed. Unappalled by the calm dignity of blameless womanhood, your minion has torn me from my spotless home and dragged me blindfold and shrieking through hedges, over stiles, and across a very difficult country, and left me
more deeply, though respectful, than my intentions towards you, it would be impossible for anyone, however particular, to desire.
Well, I'm not to be tricked by smooth words, hypocrite. But be warned in time, for there are, without, 100 gallant hearts whose trusty blade would hack him limb from limb, who dared to lay unholy hands on steed and trusty's daughter.
And this is what it is to embark upon a career of unlicensed pleasure.
Hark ye, miscreant, ye have secured me, and I am your poor prisoner. But if you think I cannot take care of myself, then you are very much mistaken. Now then, it's 1-1, and may the best man win.
No, Dame Hannah, no.
She dreaded not its power. She was happy.
when she found that he was feeble, was that great old tree. She was in a pretty pickle, as she well might be. But his gallantries were meekle, for death followed with his sequel, and the tears began to trickle for the great old tree. Sing hey, lack-a-day. Sing hey, lack-a-day. Let the tears fall free for the pretty little flower and the great oak tree. Sing hey, lack-a-day.
Turn out that
I'm not a bad baronet after all. How would you love me then?
Oh, passionately, madly.
As before?
Why, of course.
My darling.
Oh, hey, the bridegroom has arrived, and the nuptial knot is tied.
Will you be quiet?
Belay, my lad. You don't understand.
Oh, sir, belay, if it's absolutely necessary.
Belay? Certainly not.
When a man has been a naughty baronet and expresses deep repentance and regret, you should help him if you're able, like the mousey in the fable. Does the teaching in my book of etiquette?
Does the teaching in my book of etiquette?
Having been a wicked baronet for a week, once again a modest livelihood I seek. Agricultural employment is to me a keen enjoyment, for I'm naturally dividend and me.
For he's naturally dividend and me.
If you ask why I do not pipe my eye, like an honest British sailor, I reply that the Zora flyness, the regret and cheating, which is just the sort of ration I enjoy.
Which is just the sort of ration I enjoy.
Brought me by a keen desire to invoke
all the blessed talk of that you know to meet you. We shall toddle off tomorrow from this shade of sin and sorrow, for to settle in the town of Maiden's